Today, we have the great pleasure of welcoming back one of our own. Brian Russ got his PhD here working with Yale Cohen. He got the PhD in 2008, and then he went on to Harvard to have a postdoc with Mark Hauser from 2008 to 2010. He was doing behavioral studies in the macaque. And from 2010 until the present, he's been working with David Leopold at the National Institutes of Mental Health in the Laboratory of Neuropsychology there, doing combined monkey fMRI single unit recording while monkeys watch natural movies. And so I just want to call everybody's attention to not only Brian Russ's talk, but we also have a talk by Michael Casey in a week. Again, our very own Michael Casey from the Departments of Music and Computer Science. So it'll be at the same time next week at 4 o'clock. And then I also want to call people's attention to, let's see if I can get this up. Here we go. On the same website, we have the talks and videos. And so you can, if you look at this talk, you can, this is just an example.
I'm nervous as all hell, and I go in.
So you can
this step here. So that even though this state itself is not rewarded, it can provide
that's why there's a reward,
so that we can fill out all the values in this whole tree and learn to take actions that
also
don't give immediate reward, but put us in a situation where we can get reward later.
And will be available, I think, within a week or so, right, Jay? So these talks are great resources. They're viewed a lot. You can, you know, show, as I'm showing here, you can actually show it to a class in this room. And you know, and then you know, get a free lesson. So, without further ado, I'd like to give the floor to Brian.
So, what I'd like to talk to you guys today about is how natural visual experience is processed in the brain. What I've been doing is I've been conducting a number of studies, both using electrophysiology and neuroimaging, to try and understand how visual information is taken into the brain and broken down and processed, and see if we can understand what features are being processed by the visual areas. Question always comes up, what do I mean by natural vision? And so, for me, during natural visual experience, the brain is taking in a ton of information at any given moment. And so, like you can see here in this movie, there's two monkeys grooming each other, another two in the back here playing, one just lounging around. This guy's hanging out here. In a minute, a guy's going to come in and jump on him. and all this is occurring at one time. And it's very easy for us to take all this in and see all of this and understand it. And the same is true for the monkeys. They have no problem processing all this social and visual information. Yet, from a neuroscience standpoint, it's really hard to understand how each of these individual things are being taken into the brain and processed. There's a lot of information there that needs to be broken down and then built back up. And so the goal of my research is to really try and understand how the brain is actually doing that, how it's taking all that dynamic information and breaking it down. I'm not the first person to try and do this. A lot of research has come before that's looked at how visual information is processed in the brain. Going way back in time, that's been basically the stimulus that people prefer. Looking at some stuff from Leslie Ungerleiter and Mort Mishkin, we can talk about the ventral and dorsal processing stream. We've learned a lot about vision by breaking it down by this information of the what, where kind of pathway and stuff like that. So that's what you see here. This is an updated version of it from Leslie's group about where information is being sent along these processing streams. And people have generally tried to understand how visual information is processed in the brain by using a pared-down stimulus, by presenting stimuli such as a bunch of faces, then some houses, maybe some places and bodies, scrambled image or two, and you can present these things in a block design if you're using fMRI, You can do kind of event-related. You can even do event-related, or you can just present them in neurophysiological standpoints. You just do like a categorization experiment. But inevitably, most of these stimuli have been presented as a stimulus, often grayscaled, on a black or gray screen. And they're presented really fast. So in a block design, you're often presenting, so say for the monkeys, we'll present stimuli where the face changes every 2 seconds. And you show 12 faces in 24 seconds, and then you start showing some objects after that. And the same thing, the object changes every 2 seconds. Now, never in my life have I been walking around and had faces just change dramatically every 2 seconds. Swaroop is probably going to be sitting there, still being Swaroop, in another 40 minutes. But even with that being true, there's tons of dynamic information that's going on. People are fidgeting in their seats. People are going to get up, come back in. Someone's probably going to fall asleep. All this stuff is going to go on during the talk, and I'm going to be taking all of this in. And so the previous research using these block designs has found some very interesting results. They've been able to localize particular regions that supposedly, at least, seem to be processing these particular stimulus classes. So you can find areas that in the STS of the monkey that are particularly responsive to faces in the red, body parts here in yellow. And we've learned a lot about these types of object processing through these block design type of and very reduced stimuli. But the question remains, we don't know if that's actually what the brain is doing when a real world stimulus is being presented. Are these areas still processing things, like are face patches still doing face, are they still responding to faces when there's all this other information going on in a given scene? So to investigate that, in the first set of experiments that I did, I had monkeys watching 5-minute movies, and they viewed 15 different movies that each had different social content. The same movie was repeated 3 to 5 times per day. We got an average of about 15 presentations per movie over the entire time scale of the study. And we got whole brain images. For you fMRI people, we had a 1.5 isotropic whole brain imaging and at a TR of 2.4 seconds. And we were not doing bold. We were doing using Myon as a contrast, which allows us to get better signal to noise and allows us to isolate the blood volume component of the response. We did this with 3 monkeys. 2 of them have this full data set. A 3rd has a reduced data set. All the results I'm going to show you here hold up for all 3 of the monkeys. So the first thing we wanted to do was say, well, how reliably is the brain actually responding to these movies? Is it doing a similar thing trial to trial? Because if it's doing something completely different each trial, well, we have to approach this experiment a little bit differently. So what you see here is the response from one voxel during the viewing of one of the movies. I'm not going to make much out of this other than the fact that, well, it's kind of noisy, right? You see a lot of ups and downs. If you saw this for one particular trial, if you were doing a block design, you'd pretty much want to throw out this guy's data. However, you present a second movie on the same day, and it is nearly identical response. You present it a 3rd time, same response. We do it up to 15 different times over multiple days, and you get nearly the exact same response every single time the monkey watches this movie. This is true for a large portion of the brain. So color scale is a little off here. These should be more green. But you see here in red, all these areas have, over the 15 movies, this is the average correlation value between the trials and then averaged across movies. And you can see here in red, the majority of the visual stream all the way down through the temporal lobe has a very high correlation between individual trials. I don't want to make too much out of the actual value. I could make that value anything you want. Just tell me how you want me to average things together, and that thing will be high. Point is that if you look at the differences here, all of the visual stream, including up into the prefrontal cortex and LIP, is really being engaged by these movies. And what's important for what I'm going to talk about next in terms of how the individual areas are responding to these, to the features in the movie, each area has a very different temporal component to their response. They all look different. So you see here in MT, we have one particular response. V4 has a different response. TE, way different. A1, which we had no auditory stimulus, has a very low correlation and no response. None of this is particularly surprising, but what it allows us to do is say, okay, what I'm going to do now is, instead of looking at this on a trial-by-trial basis, I'm going to take the mean response to a given movie and use that as that's the natural response for that voxel for that movie.
Is that right, the frontal? Is that frontal eye field?
This includes frontal eye field. It also has 46V, which is just below frontal eye field, and also F5, which would be like the mirror neuron regions. Frontal eye field should be right about there. So what we're going to do now is, using this average response, I want to see if I can map particular features that are occurring in the movie onto the brain, if I can see where they're being processed in the brain, similar to like you would do with a block design. So what I did is, I have these 15 different movies. These are random clips, frames from within the movie. So you can see that there's a lot of different things going on. Yes, I had an entire movie filled with polar bears. We code that just the same as we'd code any of the movies with humans or rhesus or anything like that. And the responses are very similar even to these things with very different stimuli that you wouldn't expect the monkeys to have known. I'm fairly certain none of my monkeys had seen a polar bear before this moment.
Are the monkeys sedated?
Nope. Monkeys are awake and behaving. I have eye movement data from every single trial. I'm not going to talk very much about the eye movement data here. That's still an ongoing process in terms of the analysis, but we have, for every single trial, we have the eye movements of the monkey. On that note, for the movies I'm talking about right now, the animal spent 87% of the time within the frame of the movie. So they spent the majority of their time actually watching what was going on. On a trial-by-trial basis, there is variability in where they're looking. Some of that variability is going to be lost in the signal because I'm taking this mean. It's something we just have to recognize and deal with later. So we plan on doing some studies, analyses, that actually directly compare the eye position with the and what they're looking at with the neural response. But we haven't gotten to that level yet because it takes the coding of the movies is extensive. And so what we can do is we can code these, speaking of coding the movies, we can code these movies for lots and lots of different visual features. And this is kind of one of those spots where we have to make choices. And so what we did was we coded it for, in this particular case, I'm going to tell you about the coding that we did for three different low-level features, the luminance, the motion, and the contrast. Luminance is simply how bright and dark, the average bright and darkness of the frame. Contrast is the contrast in the frame, so how much there's change in the frame. And then motion is, in this case, it's a very rough version of motion. What we're doing with motion here is we are calculating the average velocity between frames, so the average change between frames of the movie. So we are taking any kind of motion, whether it be biological motion, pans of the scene, zooming in, zooming out, all of this stuff is being included as the same type of motion here. So it's something that we're going to call total motion. I'm happy to discuss ways to code motion with people later. That is a topic that we've spent a lot of time on and are trying to get a better motion regressor out of. In addition to that, we also coded the movies for various different visual objects, such as the presence of an animal, the number of faces on the screen, the number of extremities on the screen. We also did heads. So we have a number of different coding schemes that we can do. For each of these, what we end up with is a time course based on the changes that are occurring in that particular feature throughout the movie. So what we can do is we can I have each movie is 5 minutes long, but I can concatenate all the movies together to create one giant time course out of all of my movies. And I can do the same thing with the response of the voxels. And so what we can do here is we take the time course for the motion, we downsample it to the rate of the fMRI signal, and convolve it with a kernel to match it to the hemodynamic response, and then we can compare them to each other. So what we do here is we take the face feature model, and then I can take a voxel from somewhere in the brain. In this case, it's from this particular voxel is from the anterior face patch, which we localized using a standard block design localizer. And what we can do is we can just do a simple correlational method to compare how similar are these two time courses.
How does the face regressor go up and down?
The face regressor goes up and down based on, so that's a good question. It's going to change based on choices we made. So in this case, there's two ways that I'm going to show you that I did this. One is we counted the number of faces on the screen. And so across the 2.4 seconds that is a TR, we have the average number of faces in that particular TR. The other way that I did it is to have the presence of a single face on the screen. So in that case, only when there's one face on the screen was there a one or a zero in the face regressor. And in that case, it becomes the percentage of time that one face was on the screen for the TR. Same thing is going to happen with the motion. The motion is going to be the average motion for that TR. The breaks here represent the spots where a different movie is beginning. And so what we can do is we can do that for every voxel in the brain, and we can get a map out of what areas have a similar time course as the actual feature that we're coding. And so what you can see here is we get very punctate regions along the superior temporal sulcus for when we use the face regressor. If we compare that to the block design that we do in the exact same animal, we see here in the dotted black lines the representation from the block design, and they match nearly perfectly to each other. So using the movie data, I can map the exact locations of the face patches just as well as you can do with faces versus like scrambled images or objects. Now, most people are going to, you might be thinking, well, who cares? But the interesting thing about this is I can do this with as little as 15 minutes worth of movie data. And with the movies, you don't have to spend any time training the monkey to actually fixate on an object or get reward for anything. They will inherently watch these movies. This is something actually almost enjoyable for them. We have one monkey that I'll talk about later who was never rewarded a single time for watching these movies and yet watched them consistently throughout the experiment that she ran in. And so you may be able to map the face patches much quicker with this, with only 15 minutes of a movie. So what we found was that we can easily map the face patches with this movie data, and it matches very, very well with what you see during your more reduced stimulus block design type of experiment. But the question kind of remains, is that what these areas are actually doing? And so what I've only done so far is shown you the face regressor, but I used a lot of different features in my data. And so what you see here is a surface map of the face data that I showed you before. Here's the location of three of those face patches. Now, if I compare that to when we use the motion regressor, motion's just blowing it out of the water. And this, again, is just simply a correlational method here. But you can see the correlation with motion throughout the superior temporal sulcus and in IT, prefrontal regions, is extremely high throughout the brain. It gets upwards of, in MT, not surprising, it gets upwards of 0.7 correlation with the motion regressor. Interestingly, V1 here, this is foveal V1, is actually showing a negative correlation or zero correlation with the motion feature. And what we think is going on there is that the because things are being foveated, when things are being foveated, you stabilize the motion. There's much less motion processing actually going on in the regions that are being foveated. This is the only area within most of the visual cortex that shows a low response to motion. Even extrafoveal V1 is showing a high response to motion. So we can do this for numerous different features, like I was talking about before. And what we can see here is, this is the motion that I showed you before. We can use a local motion and local motion removes things like global sweeps and pans of the camera, zooms. Those things will be removed from the local motion, but things like animals moving or trees moving is not going to be removed. We still see a very high response throughout the superior temporal sulcus and temporal lobe, but it is a bit lower than the total motion. Luminance, interestingly, is isolated to the region that we showed no response in the motion. So luminance is only being coded for in the foveal V1. Everything past foveal V1 just doesn't care about changes in luminance. Similarly, contrast actually has a higher response than luminance in V1 and continues into areas like V3 and V4, but once you get into more anterior portions of the ventral visual stream, things stop caring about contrast as well. And I think what this is interesting for is that it suggests that we don't need to spend, if you're looking at things about higher level vision, we don't need to spend as much time worrying about that our stimuli are isoluminant and that the contrast levels are all equivalent throughout all the frames of your study, because if you're looking at things up in the prefrontal cortex, it just doesn't care what the luminance is. It's done. That's been already calculated earlier on. We use two different face regressors, as I was telling you about before. The face count and the isolated faces both do a good job of finding the face patches. The isolated face actually does a better job of that. I want you guys to remember that, because I'm going to come back to that when I'm talking about the neurophysiology. I think that's really important, that it's the presence of an isolated face that's driving these, that's actually causing the highest response in these regions.
Isolated faces. When there's only one face.
There's
on the
only one face on the screen.
Binary regressor.
Yep.
And then the face count is
the face count is the number of faces.
Two or more.
Yep.
And it goes up to
yep. Just goes up to maximum of 20. After 20, we just put in 21 as the number. We just decided we didn't need to count any higher than that. That may be the wrong choice. There aren't very many scenes when there's more than 20 monkeys on the screen, but it did happen occasionally. There were some scenes where it's just impossible to count the number of faces. The resolution of the particular faces, you can't decide if the monkey would actually be able to tell there was a face there or not. So as I've been talking about this whole time, the only thing I've been telling you about is correlations. And all of these features that I've been using are superposed with each other. So they're all happening at the same time. And there are inter-feature correlations. And so in order to truly compare feature to feature, we need to deal with these correlations between the features. So what we did is we submitted all of our regressors and all of our voxels into a stepwise regression. And what that simply is we compare the features to, we compare a voxel's response to each of the features. The feature that explains the most variance on that particular iteration gets put into the model. Then we compare all the rest of the features to the residuals from that particular comparison. And we keep iterating that until no feature can add more than 1% more variance to the model. The addition of a feature causes one of the previous features to go below 1%, that one that went below 1% would be kicked out of the model. And it keeps going until it stabilizes. Generally speaking, it stabilizes pretty quick after 2 to 3 features get entered into the model. So what we can get out is the total explained variance by the model. What we found is that, again, showing from earlier that we had a really good response throughout the visual cortex, we can again explain a decent amount of variance. throughout most of the ventral visual stream, even up into the prefrontal cortex here, upwards of 50% in areas like MT and FST, and you know, a pretty decent 25 to 30% of the variance is being explained within the temporal lobe. So we still have some more to go. There's still more variance that we can explain, but we're doing pretty well, especially compared to what you might see with things like a block design, where we're talking about percent signal change of one less than a percent often. So what we want to do, though, how much variance we're explaining overall isn't really the question. The question is what different features are going into the individual areas, and how much variance is each feature accounting for in a voxel's response. So to look at that, what we can do is we can break down individual areas by creating ROIs out of the regions of the brain. If we look at MT, we see that motion is explaining nearly all of the variance in that area. Again, up to about 50% of the variance with a little bit of contrast coming in there. Looking at other regions in the ventral visual stream, some of the earlier regions, we can look at extrafoveal V1 and V4. And again, motion is the feature that seems to be driving these areas the most. Contrast is coming in somewhat in extrafoveal V1, as I showed you before. Luminance and extremity count actually have a little bit in V1. V4, same. We have contrast and a little bit of this extremity count. And what's interesting about V4, though some people have seen a little bit of motion selectivity in V4, it's generally not considered a motion-responsive region. It's mostly talked about in terms of its object processing area, as an object processing area. Yet we're seeing that motion is the thing that seems to be driving it the most so far in our hands.
So motion will induce contrast change as well.
Yeah, so we've accounted for that a little bit by knowing that we calculate contrast and motion separately, and they have a relatively low correlation, the two features. So,
well, I mean, for example, moving from here to here, you see contrast edge moving from this field to that visual field.
Yes, that is true. So there will be that. Well, so the visual field isn't going to matter so much here because the monkey's moving their eyes throughout the entire trial. So we actually don't know where in the visual field there is a particular, which visual field the monkey, any particular object is falling on the monkey's retina. That's something we do want to look at. We want to look at something, eventually we're going to look at things whether they are foveated or extrafoveated. But I don't believe that, I think the way that we're calculating contrast and motion, well, contrast and luminance are going to be affected, are going to affect motion. I don't think we have much of a confound between the two due to the fact that we know that the correlation between them is fairly low and that they were independently coded.
So the contrast is average contrast?
Yeah.
I thought you told us before that motion wasn't a strong predictor in V1. Was that compared to...
This is extrafovea. I don't have the foveal V1 up here, but if you look at this particular graph for foveal V1, it's almost zero. I think it's maybe 1% of the variance is being explained by motion there, at most. It might actually fall out completely. I'm not positive on that. Foveal V1 is not responding to motion, and that's seen here in this same analysis as well.
Have you considered comparing, since you can image the whole brain, comparing the original movie with some kind of frame scrambled version of the same thing?
So we haven't done specifically that. We've done some versions where we have, I've done one version where we have a shuffling that isn't quite that fine, but I've done three different shuffles, one where I did it at a scene level, so it's shuffling every 40 seconds. So that's not a very fine shuffle. And then I've gone down to 16 seconds and also 4 seconds. I haven't spent a lot of time looking at that data yet, so I actually can't answer what happened with that. But looking at Uri Hassan's data, who's looked at this kind of thing, looking at temporal receptive fields in the visual areas, he sees that there's a gradient of responses that change as you move from posterior to anterior. So more posterior regions need less coherent information in order to be consistently responsive to regions. And then as you get more anterior into the temporal lobe and also into the prefrontal cortex, you need increasingly larger amounts of coherent temporal information in order to see a response. Yeah. And so I haven't had a chance to analyze that data yet, but we do have some of that recorded, and I expect I'll see something very similar to that with this. Looking a little bit more forward on this, if we look at the face patches that I was showing you earlier that I could pick out with the movies and also with the block design, what kind of features are going into these areas? And what we found is that, once again, faces has now shown up as one of the higher features that's being responsive in here in green, but it's being blown out of the water by motion throughout these face patches. And you have to remember, when we're talking about face patches are defined originally based on their having a higher response to faces than anything else. Yet here we're seeing that faces is not the thing that's driving them the most. They're most responsive to the changes that are occurring in the scene.
In all these regressions, probably motion might be first, right? Because that shows up as highest.
Yes.
So what happens if you put in the face regressor first and then let that soak in the most gradient?
I believe that, I haven't tested that yet. I should test that, actually. I believe this will actually stay about the same. What I think will happen is this will go up slightly, but motion will still be higher. But some of this variance will be eaten up by motion. The reason I think that's true, the motion and face regressor have a nearly zero correlation, which we did not design into the study. That just happened to be the way the movies were produced. And so the variance that's going to be eaten up by the face will not take out much of the fluctuations that are being picked up by the motion regressor. It will, I think, eat up some of it, but not very much. So I think this will end up being the same. But I actually should test that. And so what we can do is we can break the temporal lobe up into the ventral bank of the STS and the lateral surface of the IT cortex. The reason to do this is motion has been shown to be responsive to areas within the STS, the ventral bank of the STS, have been shown to be highly responsive to motion. There's a number of studies out there showing that obviously areas like MT, but even things more anterior to MT, show a higher response to moving stimuli than static stimuli. But generally speaking, things along the lateral bank have been shown to be more object-based and less responsive to motion. So are we just picking up on this ventral bank response here? So we can see here when we compare the percent of the variance explained along individual slices within the ventral bank, we see that motion is showing a high response throughout. Here's MT. The green here represent the two locations of two of the face patches. And you can see here that throughout most of the ventral bank, motion has a higher response than any other feature. And there's this gradient of motion information as you go farther along in the brain. So the motion response is changing. As you get more anterior, the percent of variance that's explained by the motion is going down, but it's still higher than most of the other features. If we look at the lateral surface, we see a similar response. Here in V4, we have a very high response to motion, and then a sharper but still gradient of motion response as you go more anterior towards the anterior pole. In the IT cortex, contrast is actually explaining some of the variance, sometimes often equal to motion, but still motion is always one of the highest responses, even in the lateral bank, an area that has not been shown to show responses to motion stimuli before. Whereas the face patches, you have these little blips here and there. So I'd argue that these areas may not be as face responsive as people tend to suggest when they're using these more simplified stimuli. But I'm not arguing that these areas are not involved in biological information. I think it is biological information that they're responding to. And one of the reasons I suggest that is, as a control study, what we did was we ran three additional movies that had absolutely no social information in them whatsoever. They were scenes of natural disasters, so they have lots of motion in them, but no animals in them anywhere. And what we see here is if we look at the motion response to the normal movies and the contrast response, we see that, again, there's a high amount of motion being processed in the ventral stream and IT cortex. Contrast is located mostly in the early visual cortex. When we do the movies without any social information, motion drops out most of these regions, particularly along the IT cortex. And even the areas within the superior temporal sulcus have now dropped down way below the amount of variance that was being explained when there were social animals in the scene. However, contrast hasn't changed at all. The percent of variance explained by contrast is still the same. So what we think this suggests is that these areas, though they may not be doing specific object categories, are responding to biological information, particularly biological motion. So what I'd like to finally finish up on is talking to you about some data that we've been collecting and most recently, and we're still kind of trying to wrap our heads around what we've seen with this new data set. And that is, we've been recording from three animals using a new electrode bundle that we can implant. It's a chronic microwire array. We can implant 32 or 64 channel bundles. We come down from a vertical position, and then when you extend the electrode, it splays out a little bit at the end. So you can see that here in this CT scan. And all the electrode tips are going to be within 1 millimeter of each other. So we're talking about an area that's smaller than one of the voxels that I was just showing you the data from. And this is in collaboration with someone else in the lab, David McMahon. He's the one that helped develop these electrodes and was using them for another experiment, during which we were able to collect using the same movies that I used in the fMRI, we collected this neurophysiological data. We have three monkeys. Two of them had electrodes just posterior to the anterior face patch I showed you before. The third monkey, where we have most of our data from, the electrode is right in the middle of the anterior face patch. So we can actually look at the responses in the face patch of neurons while they're viewing these movies. So here's just a quick look at where the position of the electrode is in two of these animals. The two lines here represent the anterior posterior for these electrodes. And so what I'm going to show you here is the response of one neuron to, I think it's 10 trials of watching the same movie. They watched this movie over 3 different days. The great thing about these new electrodes that we have is that we can record the same set of neurons for days, weeks, even months at a time sometimes. So we can hold the same neuron, be sure that it's the same neuron, and get multiple trials across longer timescales. This was particularly useful for David McMahon when he was doing a longitudinal study looking at learning, but it's helpful for me because I'm able to show multiple movies that would take too long to do in one day. Now I can do that over multiple days. So in the different colors here, you see the response to a given movie across multiple trials. I know this looks a little tough to see what's going on here. If we break it down and do the SDF, you can start to see that the neuron is kind of doing the same thing on trial-to-trial basis. If we zoom in a little bit and only look at 1 minute's worth of data, it becomes much more clear that from trial to trial, this neuron is doing the exact same thing, even across 3 different days. So if we were to listen to this cell the first time it responded, it really sounds like the neuron was just responding randomly throughout the trial, but it really does repeat very well across trials. even at the spiking level, it does so. So it's not just when we do these, when we do a smoothing kernel on the spike density functions. Even at the individual spiking level, you can see the bands of activity here in the response.
Right?
Yeah.
So I'm sorry, trial, what's the difference between trial and day?
Trial and day is based, I'm just like you would think. So in here, I have three trials that were collected on the first day, then three more trials that were collected on the second day.
Played
multiple times that day. Usually what we've done, just like in the fMRI, we presented three movies on a given day. And so they would watch three different movies, usually randomly, which one was presented, up to about four presentations of each movie.
Is there some similarity of the content of the movie that relates to these peaks in the firing rate?
Great question. That's what I'm going to try and figure out and explain. The short version, no.
No?
Let me back up. That's probably wrong. I don't know what it is. But it's not obvious. It's not obvious at all. That's where we're trying to go with this and what we need to figure out. These neurons that are supposed to be object selective, especially the ones in the face patch, we do not see a very strong face response from these particular neurons. They do not jump out and say, "Wow, I love faces." That's not what they're saying to you when you're doing this in a natural viewing paradigm. And I think what it is that the brain isn't built to just do faces. And when we only present it that way, well, sure, that's what the neuron's going to respond to. But when it has the option of seeing this more naturalistic stimuli, it's a much more complex feature set that each of the neurons is responding to. And so to get to that point a little bit more, what we did is we did split halves comparisons with the neurons on the trials to figure out how reliably are the neurons responding both within a neuron and between neurons. So are they responding to the same features? So this is a within neuron trial. So this is the same neuron. You can see that it's responding very similarly across these two halves of the data. But if we look at a between neuron comparison. Now remember, these neurons are within one voxel distance of each other. They're very close to each other. They are responding completely differently from each other. There's no similarity here between these responses. And so we can do this comparison for all of the neurons in our data set. And we see that within neuron, there's a very high reliability across trials and days. But between neurons, it's a near zero comparison between neurons. So they between cells, even though they're super close to each other, there's very little similarity between their responses.
So these cells are really in the same column, right?
I guess you could argue that they might not be, depending on if we hit the column at the right angle or not. But yeah, pretty much they're in the same column.
So the clonal organization just does not reflect the kind of physiology that you're studying.
No, it does not seem to. Yeah. I mean, you could argue that we didn't hit the column at the right angle. I can't argue for or against that. But other than that, no, I don't think this supports a columnar organization.
But you see the cortical surface relative, and you image the electrode.
Yeah.
When the electrodes are spread out, how far, what's the distance that they're spread out?
So it's tough to say exactly, but I can show you the CT image we did on one electrode. And it's within 1 millimeter.
And what's the column distance?
Yeah, about that.
In V1, so I don't know about
V1. So you'd have to hit the column just
I mean, yeah, but V1's probably going to have the smallest columns. I mean, I think anterior temporal lobes would show them to have much larger ones when they've seen it.
Yes, but I mean, so if that's 1 millimeter that's played out, you'd have to hit the column perfectly.
For potentially.
All those electrodes, wires being the same.
Well, that's what I said. I can't guarantee that I am not crossing a column, but there are very few neurons that are, even if I was crossing a column, let's say I am crossing a column, there are very few neurons that are showing between trial high correlations, very few. So you'd expect at least some of them to show that if they were crossing the column.
You've got some pretty high correlations
there. A few, yeah. But like I said, I'm not 100% positive that that's not what's going on here. But I don't think this data supports a columnar organization. I don't think it necessarily refutes it, though. So what we can do is we decided to take the responses from 48 neurons that were recorded from one of the monkeys in the anterior face patch. So all of these neurons here were recorded from the face patch. We localized the face patch using fMRI in this monkey, and we have a separate data set, unfortunately on a separate set of neurons, that shows that the neurons in this region are responding more strongly to faces than other objects when you do a standard categorization task with these animals. So we're very certain we're in a face patch here. And so what we did was we ran a principal components analysis on the response to, I think it was three movies. And what we found is we found three different clusters of neurons within the within this area, mostly being broken down by their response on principal component one. And so if we organize our responses, I know this graph's a little much, but I'll explain it throughout. If we organize this response based on the number of the neurons rank in principal component one, what we end up seeing, and so here is that top group, here's that middle group, and here's the bottom group down here for the rankings. We see these columns of organized responses in the first group. Throughout the rest of that time, the neurons are responding kind of independently of each other, but along these particular moments, there seems to be something that's locking all these neurons onto the same response. And so what we can do is we can look at what's happening right around the time that's happening, and what's occurring is that in most of these cases, there's a large face being presented on the screen, and that face is often right after a scene cut, which is essentially what you would see the response of when you're doing a categorization experiment or a block design. It's the most artificial portion of all of my stimuli. This abrupt scene cut, there's a flash in the screen, and then a face appears out of nowhere. Again, something that wouldn't happen in nature. During the rest of that time, these neurons are responding fairly differently from each other. So if we look at the correlation between these cells when we break it up this way, what we see is there is a higher between neuron correlation, mostly attributed to these bands of activity. Whereas in the middle patch here, it's not that these neurons aren't correlated with each other. They have a high inter-trial correlation. It's just that they're not very correlated with each other. They're doing something completely differently from each other. Interestingly, this third group here, which I'm not going to focus much on, but what they seem to be responding to is there's a couple of neurons that seem to have these couple of bands here, and they respond, those bands seem to be right around the time of a very wide shot scene. So there's a big open area and maybe an animal or two in it. But again, this is neurons within a face patch that seem to have this response to something that would be very non-face-like. So the only neurons that seem to be having any form of a particularly strong face response are these top set here, which represent less than half of the neurons, but close to half. And these are not the only presences, these are not the only times that there is a large face on the screen. It's just the times when there's a flashed large face. If we look at the response, so this is, I've alluded to this a number of times throughout the talk, watching a neuron and seeing how it responds. I'm gonna let you guys all play that game right now. This is a neuron from the middle section of that, from the middle group of the responses I showed you just before. And I'd love for someone to tell me what this neuron is responding to. So what you're gonna hear is the spiking response of the neuron summed over all of the trials. You'll want to pay attention to this graph right here. This is going to show you the actual spikes that were occurring during the trials. This will be the movie. And down here is the whole population response. So we're going to go from here to about over here. So it's about 15, 20 seconds of a movie here. Got an idea?
Motion.
Action initiation.
But is it one particular type of motion? Because there was a lot of biological motion going on there, and well, I mean, I think it's motion too. But
time things got still, the neurons seem to.
Yeah, but it would be
the rhythm of the
engagement from some social behavior.
Potentially, I don't know. But this is all within a face patch, and no one said faces. so. I don't know. That's the thing that we want to figure out. I wish I had a final answer for you as to what these cells are doing. I have some experiments that I plan on running that I think is going to clear this up a little bit more, but we haven't had a chance to do them. So one thing that we plan on doing is, since we have these electrodes that we can now hold neurons for multiple days, weeks at a time, what we're going to do is present a massive data set. Collect a massive data set by presenting category stimuli, movies, biological motion versus random dots, mechanical motion, all these different types of stimuli, and then be able to say, okay, this neuron in a categorization experiment shows that it's face responsive. What happens during the movie? Do we still see that kind of response? What happens when we present biological motion versus random dot motion? How do these things change the response properties of the neuron? Going back to Howard's question earlier, one of the things we plan on doing with this exact data set that I'm talking about is to present movies where we vary the amount of coherent information presented at one time by scrambling the movies at various different timescales and seeing how much temporal information is necessary for the neuron to respond to that motion that we just saw. And so, unfortunately, I get to leave you with, however, few neurons exhibit an easily discernible set of trigger features. I personally think that's really interesting because people really want to believe that this area, we know that this area is doing faces. That is what everyone thinks they know about this region, and yet I don't see that in my data. And so I'd like to thank my current lab and all the people that helped with this experiment. Thanks, guys.
So maybe I missed something, but in your fMRI data, a lot of the stuff that you focused on was based on the kind of the variance that was explained by your stepwise regression model.
Yes.
Right? But like stepwise regression models are kind of notorious for inflating R-square values sometimes. Have you done any like cross-validation just to...
We haven't done any cross-validation yet, but that's a good idea. We should run one of those. We try to be very careful about adding in too much explained variance by putting limitations on what the model is allowed to do, but it would be good to run a cross-validation. So we want to make sure we don't just let it inflate by just adding in things.
Have you considered using maybe taking your sort of like face presence regressor and then coding it separately for different like profiles and different angles?
We have actually done that. So the original data, the original coding of the faces was done as a profile versus a full view versus, well, not versus, but in addition there was a head. So head could exist without being able to see the face. And then you had a full view where you could see the full eyes and mouth, or you had the profile view where you could only see the side of the face. We found that all of these work to map the face patches. I think even the heads maps the face patches. But heads includes faces. I haven't done heads minus faces. I don't know what would happen with that one.
It just seems, the neuron that you just showed, to me, like, seemed like it would pop every time the monkey would look in like a different direction.
Yeah, that's one of the more recognizable features I've seen in that data set, in that one. What I haven't had a chance to do yet is do the feature regressions on the neurons. And that is a step that we're planning on doing soon to see if we can pick out some of this. And I'm sure motion's gonna be one of the things that's driving these neurons to some extent. But again, something I find at least interesting is that the diversity of the responses between these neurons is pretty high. So I don't think I'm just gonna be able to show that motion is responsible for all of the neural response, because there's just too much of a variability in the response of each individual neuron for that to be true.
Have you looked at any motion areas?
Recording-wise, yeah. No. We haven't had a chance to do that. The reason this data set is what it is right now in terms of the neurophysiology is David McMahon was running a separate study. It was a very good chance to collect this data set together, but we weren't able to optimize it. The electrodes were placed where they were for other reasons than this particular study. We are now gonna go in and start placing electrodes, these similar electrodes, in other monkeys in regions that are very targeted for our particular interests.
Are you gonna include more posterior areas? Would you expect to see more between cell similarity and?
I don't know, I'm not sure. That's a good question. Maybe, I know that's not a very good answer, but I'm not sure what to expect in terms of the between cell similarity. What I think we'll get.
Good to look in, I don't know, V1, I mean,
I'm trying my best to stay away from V1, because I've been informed many a times that once you go to V1, you will never ever be allowed to leave V1. You get trapped there for the rest of your career, so I'm gonna stay as far away from V1 as I can. Doing the fMRI for V1's fun, I'll stay there and there, but no. I do think it would be interesting to do that. Jack Gallant has
just
been
to
doing-
see that it differs in different areas.
Yeah, so Jack Gallant's been doing, I don't know about if he's looked at the like correlation between neurons. He's been doing recordings. He presented this at SFM, where he's been doing some recordings in V4 and finding something very similar to what we're finding, which is the response feature, like the feature trigger for these V4 neurons is extremely complex. It's not just, oh, it's an oval or, you know, it needs to have this particular set of corners. It's a very complex temporal dynamic that is necessary for it to cause to truly be a feature for V4. And so I think what you're gonna see, but again, it's not like, at least in their hands, they haven't shown that it's a face, you know, or any other object. Like it's not necessarily a biological object for them. So what I think you're gonna see is, as we move posterior to anterior, the response property is going to get increasingly more complex and increasingly rely on temporal dynamics. So more temporal information is going to be necessary to actually find the true trigger feature for these neurons. So when we're back in V1, I don't think it's going to take a very complex or long temporal receptive window for those regions. But as you move more forward, you will. And we're really far anterior here. So I think these neurons are looking for something much more complex than just the presence or absence of faces or bodies or something like that. It's some group of features that may not be easily described that's going to trigger these neurons.
Could it be something like identity or something about their social like behavior related to dominance or?
I mean, it certainly, they must be picking up on this.
Yeah, it certainly could be. I don't know that we haven't necessarily. I didn't code for dominance. I code for things like behaviors like aggression and copulations, and which I've been informed I'm not allowed to show in my talks anymore. it distracts people too much when you show the copulations. I've coded for these things. Those variables within the fMRI data were not particularly useful, so I haven't really been presenting them, but we did run them.
Some of that's a little bit harder to quantify in terms of, like, motion's nice because once you settle on whatever you're going to call motion, you can get very precise about what the regressor should look like. But
exactly.
Something like a dominance regressor or a behavior regressor would be a little bit trickier.
That's one of the problems we have with it. It becomes a very binary regressor, and the binary regressors have, other than the face one, but even that becomes less binary. They don't work super well in this kind of paradigm.
So even though all the neurons in this little patch aren't correlated with each other, since they're correlated with themselves, they're kind of engaged in the same like dance or whatever, right?
Yeah.
So they all have a role to play.
Yes.
And they're playing their role consistently.
Yes. They know their role. So they know what they're doing.
Is there a way to combine the time courses of all these neurons to understand what the whole picture is?
That's a great question. It's something we're actually working on right now. One of the things that we're looking at is, again, I mentioned, they're all within the space of one voxel, right, that I recorded from. And so what we're doing is actually we have another postdoc in the lab who's using this data set right now to look at can you, using the LFPs or the spiking of individual neurons or the ensemble, compare it directly to the fMRI response. Now, right now, because of the way we did these recordings, it's actually different animals. But we've already seen that there is some similarity between animals in terms of, well, not necessarily the neuron-to-neuron response. We haven't checked that. But in terms of the fMRI response, there is similarity between regions across monkeys. So we think it's reasonable to test whether or not we can see that the response in this area that we know corresponds to this voxel in this other animal, because we know where the face patches are. Is it showing a similar response to anything around there or other areas in the brain?
So quick, following up on Andy's question, could you look at the information content in the population? So you're analyzing each cell in isolation. You've got 48
cells right now.
48 cells there. And you could look at the pattern of activity and how that's changing over time.
That's true.
And can you tell what part of the movie the animal's watching from that population response in one millimeter patch of cortex?
I think you could. We haven't tried that. It's something worth trying, but we haven't tried that particular. I think with the diversity of responses that they're showing and the similarity within neuron, I think actually that would be pretty easy to do because they have enough diversity of response that I think you'd be able to get pretty accurate about which portion of the movie is being presented.
And then would those patterns somehow correlate with the features?
Yeah.
Like the presence of faces.
Yeah, that might be something worth trying.
Sorry, I had a question about the motion issue.
Sure.
I was just wondering, so it seems like in scenes like this, the motion may be partly capturing the sort of rate of change of things happening in the film that the monkey
is
watching?
Very much true, yes.
So how much of that do you think is really purely stimulus-driven versus a difference in the amount that the monkey is shifting their attention around or shifting their eyes around more in scenes with a lot of things changing quickly? Versus
sure. So we actually, I haven't presented that data set here, but we, like I said, we've recorded the eye movements of the animal throughout all of these trials. And we have another set of analyses that we've been working on that specifically look at the eye movements, ignoring the feature set, data set, with the exception of motion, which we just kind of include because it's so prominent in our features. We want to see exactly kind of what you're talking about, how it compares. And what we found is that the number of saccades and the velocity of the saccades are not correlated with regions that are showing high motion. So motion is not the thing that's necessarily creating the number of saccades that are occurring. That's some other movie features, probably something to do with the social information that's increasing or decreasing the number of saccades or the velocity that the saccades are happening at. So what we found is that regions outside of the ones we're seeing with motion tend to be the ones that are correlated with the frequency of saccading. In particular, we're finding regions that I didn't talk about a lot here, but in the prefrontal cortex. There's some interesting results in the prefrontal cortex with the saccade data.
Sorry. My last little question. So have you teased out what, in terms of the motion, whether it's the head that's moving versus body movement, or?
I haven't, so that's really, really hard to code. I know that's a bad answer to that kind of thing, but it's true. We are working on that right now. We're working on a coding scheme that will allow us to specifically say, this head moved, this was body was moving, this motion is actually due to scene shifts. So we're working on that coding right now, but it is a very long process. So we will get there, but we don't have that yet.
You need a room full of undergraduate research assistants.
I do, but we don't have any, you know, NIH, no undergrad research assistants. We have.
There's an advantage.
I know.
Well, I think, thank Ryan for a fabulous talk.